Oh, there we go. All right. Start going to Zoom for this one. All right, everyone, welcome to another edition of the colloquium. I assume you can hear us. Please shout on the chat if there's a problem with audio quality. And I think we're streaming. So our speaker today is Ntsikelelo Charles. So somewhat unusually for a colloquium speaker, he doesn't actually have a degree. So he's our first non-doctor speaker, but he's done some very cool work with Hera, and we haven't heard about Hera for a while. So I think this will be a very interesting colloquium anyway. As usual, please put your questions into the Zoom chat if you've got questions from the remote end, and Ntsikelelo will address them later. But otherwise, Ntsikelelo, it's all yours. Take it away.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Oli. Today I'll be presenting actually a lot of my PhD work that I've done. Oleg has mentioned, this is not very high-tech sort of array like Meerkat. So Hera is pretty much low-tech, but the kind of science that we can do with it is amazing. So my title today is probing the epoch of reionization with the hydrogen epoch of reionization array. Now, the layout is quite simple. The first thing that I'll do is do a quick review of the Big Bang Theory, and this is the big part of cosmology, and then that will lead me to the epoch of reionization. I'll also discuss some few of the challenges, not all of them, few of them that are currently faced, mostly common in all this type of science, the epoch of reionization. I'll also discuss the power spectrum and how instrumental response actually makes it difficult to measure the power spectrum. And then I'll also briefly talk about the use of closure phases, and eventually talk about a new technique. Well, not really new technique, but the use of fringe filters to somewhat help with observations of Hera, particularly again relating to the epoch of reionization. Afterwards, I will conclude. So we start, and again, the study here is of large scale structure. It's the Big Bang model. So the first thing is, again, the Big Bang model is a model that explains how the universe began and how it got to the state that it is right now. So at the very beginning there, we have the high energy realm of things. And I'm not an expert in that. I've said this many times. That's the inflationary theory. I read about it, but I'm not fairly familiar with it. But you have the universe at a single point, and then rapidly starts to inflate. Yeah, and eventually, as it inflates, it cools down rapidly. It cools down rapidly a lot, and you start forming normal matter. Now, what you have is nuclear synthesis starts to begin about 1 second after the Big Bang. So you start forming your protons and neutrons. Okay, and then protons and neutrons, and also nuclei. But you see, we have electrons zipping around. So what you have here is what we call the cosmic microwave background. And then this light couldn't propagate through the universe. And as like I said, it kept on being scattered all the time because of the free electrons. But eventually, the universe cooled enough that neutral hydrogen started to form, and the universe became transparent. And then we only started seeing this light a little bit later on, but it occurred a little bit later. So that's what we call the cosmic microwave background. There's a temperature of about 2.73 Kelvin, and then eventually the neutral hydrogen in the universe or the normal matter started collapsing together to gravitational effects, and galaxy formation started, and eventually a galaxy formation proceeded until we got to the state of the universe. Now I'll discuss what really happens from the galaxy formation to the current state of the universe. And so how can we actually probe this era? Well, there's a unique thing about the universe, is that everything that we observe by the universe is through light, and light also travels at a finite speed. Given this, it means that if we want, you know, that when we see stars, the radiation or the light from the early stars, that that depicts how the universe was in the early universe. And so the universe's history is still frozen in time, and you can still probe it the further out we look into the universe. And so that's in essence what we're doing when we're trying to probe the history of the universe, is to look further and further into the deep universe, and thereby knowing the state of the universe in those. So there are quite a few challenges faced by this, because again, as you look further and further into the universe, the light from those distant stars is very faint. So what you have is the radiation era. The dark ages is pretty much where there was nothing really happening in the universe. There was just the neutral hydrogen, and yet the first stars forming and first galaxies. Now, how these actually occurred is pretty much a debate for now, because various models predict various things in this scenario. But you've got, and then galaxies form, and then eventually the entire universe is ionized, and you get to the state that it is right now. So the period that we actually probe is called the Epoch of Reionization, and that is when the universe was reionized again, and this time to galaxy, to the formation of galaxies. And so you typically have is matter clamping together, and initially around these new galaxies that are formed, radiation energy starts to heat up the gas nearby at first. And so this progresses, and as star formation process gets energized, increasingly energized, the local hydrogen gas in those bubbles starts to ionize. So that there's the first the heating, and then eventually there's ionization by the formation of the first galaxies. And then eventually the entire universe, as you would see here, is that the entire intergalactic medium eventually gets ionized. And this is the period that we're trying to study. And why are we trying to do this? Well, the ionization and how much ionization is done at a particular period can also tell us what kind of stars were formed, what kind of stars were formed in the very first stars. And also it can also help us constrain some cosmological parameters. So that is the motivation behind studying this period. So I just need to okay. Quantum transition where hydrogen undergoes a spin flip, and it emits basically a 21 centimeter emission line. So what you have is the two protons are aligned with the hydrogen spin, and then when they're anti-aligned, that's a lower energy, and then a 21 centimeter emission is emitted. This is just a normal transition from neutral hydrogen. So if you can trace this sort of emission, then we can trace the IGM, or the intergalactic medium, or the hydrogen in the early universe, and therefore you can trace that, then we can pretty much know how the ionization occurred. Now, this again is a 21 centimeter emission, but in nowadays it's highly redshifted. So we only observe it at meter wavelengths, and this is between 50 to 250 megahertz. Okay. And also the nice thing about observing in radio waves is that they've got its longer wavelengths, so you're able to probe the universe at an earlier time, because radio is passed to most things because of their longer wavelength as well. Okay. And so what we really measure now, as I mentioned, what you've got is you've got the cosmic microwave background as your background, but you also now you have the 21 centimeter emission line from the Epoch of Reionization. So what we actually measure is not the spin temperature, okay, that is that transition from the hydrogen. What we actually measure is the brightness temperature contrast. So how does the spin temperature differ from the cosmic microwave background? And that's what we measure. And so what I'm showing here there at the top is basically the evolution of this brightness temperature contrast. So initially, everything was negative because it was the cosmic microwave background was much brighter than the spin temperature. Okay, and then eventually the gas kind of collapsed and lumped in together. And then, so that drived the gas temperature a little bit higher. And then eventually, the gas temperature through a star formation process occurs, as X-ray heating occurs, okay, the intergalactic medium starts to heat up, and it heats up above the CMB temperature. So now your brightness temperature contrast eventually becomes larger than the brightness temperature. And then eventually you don't have any spin temperature anymore because you're much of your intergalactic medium. So the Lyman alpha coupling, it's basically another mechanism in which the 21 centimeter emission line can be emitted. So what happens is that a CMB photon is absorbed by the hydrogen, neutral hydrogen, and then there's some quantum selection rules that allow it to go to a different state. And when it falls back, okay, it allows it to raise a 21 centimeter. So this is like a different mechanism, but it's not a straightforward absorption emission of the 21 centimeter emission line. Okay.
Is it happening there because that thing
starts having neutral? Yeah, most of the neutral hydrogen, and you got a lot of CMB photons as well. Okay. And then so it couples it first with the CMB photon, then you got X-ray heating from galaxy formation processes. So the X-ray heating drives the spin temperature way up the CMB. And then over here, right, it's driven it up, and then eventually there's normal brightness temperature contrast because most of the intergalactic medium is ionized by this time at a redshift of 6. Okay. So those are the two things. So there are a couple of ways now you can measure this. This is a nice mapping. Again, this is a certain reionization model. So there are a few things that you can measure here. You can also measure the average, volume average of this bright temperature contrast. And you can see there's some sort of structure. If you look at it as a function of redshift, so there is like a big absorption line that is over here, and this feature is model dependent as well. So there are two ways you can measure the average, that is the global temperature fluctuations, okay, and also you can try to measure the fluctuations of this temperature, the brightness temperature. And so here you've got different modes that pick up at different redshifts. So these are the spatial fluctuations that you can also probe this error with. And different models would predict a different average signal and also a different power spectrum signal. Okay, so there are two ways that we can do this. And typically, global signals, we measure them with a single dipole antenna. Interferometers are great at measuring spatial fluctuations. It turns out this one is not that difficult because dealing with a single dipole antenna is much more less complicated, I would say, than dealing with an interferometer, as you will see later on. Okay, so measuring spatial fluctuations is not a very new thing. It's not just with the 21 centimeter emission line. We can measure spatial fluctuations of the cosmic microwave background through, again, the correlation function. So what the correlation function does, it basically measures the degree at which they are certain regions in space. So this is a cosmological parameter, but normally attributed to matter, where matter is clamping together, okay, and where matter is sparse. So the correlation function basically just measures that degree. And if it so happens that if you take the Fourier transform of that correlation function, you get something that we call the power spectrum. So the power spectrum gives you the sense at which where fluctuations, at which spatial scales of fluctuations occur. And so this is, again, the power spectrum corresponding to these. This is the CMB temperature, okay? And this is the observed power spectrum of the CMB temperature. You can see you got multiple moment, and this is the angular scale at which those fluctuations are occurring. So that's not something new. So with the 21 centimeter emission line, what we can do is use interferometers. Now, interferometers measure something that we call the visibility function or visibility spectra. It turns out that already does a bit of work for us because it already performs a two-dimensional power spectrum. And so just by getting your visibility measurements, you've already done a two-dimensional power spectrum. And to get the third axis, okay, which is the third dimension, we just need to Fourier transform, because we know that frequency maps to redshift and redshift maps to distances along the line of sight. You simply just Fourier transform along the frequency axis, something that we call the delay spectrum. And then afterwards, you get a power spectrum, again, which measures spatial fluctuations along the line of sight and the three-dimensional power spectrum. Yeah, that's the window function. Yeah, sorry. Okay. So that's how we measure the power spectrum. We just need to get the visibilities and eventually Fourier transform them to get the power spectrum. Now, as I mentioned, all is nice, but there are a couple of problems. The first one being the EOR signal, as I said, is in the early universe. So when you observe it, it's about 5 millikelvin when you observe it. But we've got stuff that is closer to us, like the extragalactic radio emission. Okay, that's around 9.8 Kelvin. And better yet, we've got also really strong galactic foreground emission from our own galaxy. Okay, so this tends to be a problem because you've got foregrounds that are a little bright than the signal that you're trying to measure. However, we have existing catalogs for these, so we can always model these, okay, and put them in the signal chain and subtract them out to get our EOR signal. Okay, so this is pretty much easy to do with a dipole, sort of a single antenna, because a single antenna, there are not many parts that are moving, well, communicating with each other, that I would say. So it's easier to model. So what you can do is to actually measure the global average signal. So EDGES was the first team to actually report the detection of the 21 centimeter emission line to the absorption line that I mentioned earlier on. And so this is what they measured. And basically what you do is you have the observed spectrum. Again, this is temperature axis, not the visibility spectrum. Okay, and then you subtract the foreground model. And so what you get is residuals of when you have subtracted the foreground model. Notice that the foreground model here does not include the EOR signal. So what you do then, you simulate an EOR signal and you subtract now from those residuals as well a 21 centimeter emission line model. And what you get is these residuals and you get the best fit 21 centimeter model. Okay, and this is what they got. Okay, so they got the absorption line, but there are quite a few things that are controversial about this. So the peak here is about a factor of two larger than most models would predict. And so they said several other things, one being that the gas might be colder than the models predicted, or that the CMB is hotter, but we have independent measurements of the CMB, so it might be the other way around. But some authors have all this, you know, set some controversy in around the data analysis process of this as well. Some have argued, well, use the same data analysis because this is fitting a model, and so there are quite a few things that you can do around it. So some have also questioned how this model was obtained. Okay, and also some have tried to explain it by giving certain absorption or certain physical models that could explain this absorption profile that is two times larger than the expected profile. Okay.
So what's controversial? Is that controversial that it's a detection at all?
It's not controversial that it's a detection at all. It's just that it's a factor of two larger than what most models would predict. So that's the controversial part. So it either be that the models need some tuning, of which others have proposed that kind of idea, but also others in the same sort of study have also, well, used the same data, but came up with a different model that does not have this feature. So the detection is not the problem, but it's the absorption profile, what the detection actually means for the reionization models. It just doesn't fit any of the reionization models for now. You have to explore other exotic mechanisms to explain this profile. All right, so there's some good progress in this one. And again, now you have also spatial fluctuations, which are power spectrum measurements. As I mentioned, these are measured by interferometers. So what we have is HERA, which is my main focus. Here is a hydrogen epoch of reionization array. This is in South Africa. And then you have the giant meteor radio telescope. This is in India. And you have the Murchison wide-field array. And then there was the precision array probing the epoch of reionization. That was paper. It was replaced by HERA. And you also have the low frequency array in the Netherlands, I think. Okay, LOFA. All right, so these are the various interferometers set out to measure the 21 centimeter power spectrum. And the thing to note about this, especially with HERA, is that because we want a lot of sensitivity, to measure these the power spectrum, well, you need a lot of sensitivity to measure the power spectrum, you get that a lot of the antennas are closely packed together. And like I said, it's not high tech. So you got about 350 antennas, all just measuring this. And the design is very simple. This is just a mesh grid. And then you typically have the feed here, although these have been replaced with the newest Vivaldi feed. So it's a very simple layout of an array. Okay, there wasn't...
It used to be the actual paper feeds on both.
Yeah, it used to be the actual paper feeds, but now they have been replaced by the Vivaldi feeds, which have a wider bandwidth. Yeah. So that's the one thing I did at one point, although I never had to work there, but I did go out to see the array. And so this is a simulated foreground visibility spectra of the 21 centimeter emission line as well as foreground. So the solid lines are basically the visibility spectra that you would get from a typical observation of the foreground emission. Okay, and that's the solid line here. And then at the bottom here, it's the same visibility spectra that you get, but now from the 21 centimeter emission line. So you can see here, although I have to convince you that this is spectrally unsmooth, well, I don't have to do that. It's unsmooth compared to the foregrounds. Okay, and the gray line is basically the noise level. So you need to currently, in this simulation, the noise was a little bit above the 21 centimeter detection threshold. So you needed a lot of antennas. That's the basic essence. You need a lot of antennas so that you can peel in to the 21 centimeter emission line. So with this contrast between visibility spectral foregrounds being smooth and the 21 centimeter emission line being a variation, varying very rapidly with frequency, if you do a Fourier transform, you get what we call now, again, the power spectrum, the 3D power spectrum. And what's nice about this is that you get this region in the power spectrum, 3D power spectrum, where the foreground signal can be separated from the 21 centimeter emission line. So what you see here in gray is a 21 centimeter power spectrum, and then the foregrounds are the dotted line. So you can easily separate them out. Again,
that's just the smoothness.
Sorry?
That's the smoothness kicking in, right?
Yeah, that's just the smoothness kicking in off the foregrounds. Yeah, so that's the contrast there. And you can also see that the ER signal is much smaller than, sorry, the signal is much weaker than the foregrounds, but there is a region where you can actually separate these two. And there are various mechanisms. So this is one, this is called a delay spectrum approach. So where now you use the delay space to separate the foregrounds and the emission. And there are various other methods that you can also do. You can also, because the foregrounds are smooth, you can subtract them. But instrumental response makes these sort of things a little bit complicated, as you will see. So in terms of progress being made in measuring the power spectrum, so you can see these are the various power spectrum measurements that have been made, okay, by the various arrays around the world. And this is where we're trying to get to. This is a 21 centimeter emission line. So we really are orders away from getting there. Okay, we need really high sensitivity to really get to where we can start. We can rule out certain models, but you know where we can start to confirm or chuck out a large chunk of the models.
And then you still make the power of the time.
Yeah, we're still above this where we can start to discriminate a lot of the models. So Hera currently has also the latest power spectrum limits, and those are right here. So we're still quite an order of magnitude away, but they were able to rule out, even with these power spectrum limit, they were able to rule out a certain class of our reionization models. Yeah, these lines, yeah. So I plotted just the latest one. They had couple, I think they released four. So the couple of more that have been released. Just plotted the latest one from here. Okay, so like I kind of hinted before, is that working with interferometers is never simple. Firstly, you've got the antenna primary beam that you need to deal with, and since Hera was not really high tech, sort of people didn't make stringent constraints on the design. Well, no, there was a stringent constraint on design, but it was, you know, not made smooth and all that stuff. The primary beam from different antennas is typically different and it's never the same. So your rhyme changes a little bit. Okay. And then what's important about this effect, though, is that this effect of base of antenna primary beams being different is a baseline sort of based dependent effect. But however, once you get your visibility products at the end, where now you have the antenna gains further corrupting your signal, okay, you get your antenna gains. These are antenna based terms, and that's really neat. And you will see the neatness of this later on. But these two states, various corruptions, again, by the antenna primary beam and your antenna gains, give you a visibility product. And in essence, what you're trying to do is to again get your uncorrupted visibility products by at least performing calibration as up to second generation calibration. And like I said, this is the antenna primary beam. This is the main focus of my work, looking at the antenna primary beam. And so again, it's a sensitivity pattern and your target is typically on the main lobe. So you never really have to worry about anything, but you have this sort of side lobe structure that, you know, it's people try to attenuate that sort of thing because you really don't want to observe anything that is outside your field of view, but it's always there. But what's important about this is that it's non-smooth. And remember the criteria that I said is that foregrounds are smooth and the 21 centimeter is unsmooth. And so what happens is that if you couple the foreground emission with this unsmooth primary beam response, your foregrounds eventually become unsmooth. And then it becomes a little bit of a challenge to separate the ER signal. Now, this is what you would get for a normal antenna, for a normal array of antennas that are spatially spaced out. Okay. In other words, there's no cross coupling between them. However, with Hera, there's a lot of mutual coupling between the antennas because they're very close together. So what happens is that your primary beam gets modified into this sort of primary beam. So this is the primary beam that you'd get with mutual coupling. And so your side lobe structure, in other words, the signals from one antenna bounce off because, you know, there's impedance matching at the...
The way that
it bounces off and it gets reabsorbed, or we only do first order one, but it gets complicated. But first order is
to see each other.
It goes like the electronics.
Sorry, Dave?
It goes like the electronics of the
test. Not quite. It's just the signal either bouncing off from the structures or also being reflected from by the feed because of an impedance matching. To get maximum absorption, you need to match the impedances. If they're not matched, then the signal gets reflected. Okay, and then it's absorbed by a nearby. So this overall creates this sort of side lobe structure in your side. So in as much as the side lobes are not smooth, but with the effect of mutual coupling, this is enhanced. And so you can imagine a case where now you got your foregrounds that lie on this and coupled to this side to this sort of unsmooth structure of the foregrounds. And so this is what I'm also showing here on top of that is that what you also have with the primary beams, this is a side cut of the primary beams, but I want you to focus on beam 26. And beam 26 is one antenna that's at the edge of the array. So there's one side of it that's experiencing a lot of mutual coupling. That's where you see all the ripples. Okay. But then there's one side of it that is, you know, exposed to the outer side. So there are no antennas there. So there's less mutual coupling there. So the beam is asymmetric. And this is another extra complication of your problem, okay? You not only have to deal with unsmooth spectral structure of the side lobes, but even the primary beams now are different, okay? So that's another layer that we have. So it turns out then if you do this sort of calibration with Hera currently, you get gains that are spectrally really not smooth at all. And so you can see the gains here, quite a bit of spectral structure. That's the amplitude of the gains, and this is the phase. And typically what people do is say, you know what, we're going to smooth the gains now and smooth them out. And this is one way of doing it, just smooth out the gains. Okay, but you can also do a Fourier transform of the gains to look at their power at the various modes. And this kind of tells you where corruptions are actually occurring. Okay. And so you've got reflections at 14 meter, 20 meter reflections, unmolded diffuse emissions. So these lie at about this portion of the portion of the delay. And then you've got instrumental coupling. This occurs around 8 to 100. And so if you were to use these unsmooth gains to actually calibrate your data, you're pretty much setting yourself in trouble. So what you do is you smooth them out. So you cut them off right over there because you know these shouldn't be part of your gains. So you just chuck it out. Okay. So that's one thing that you can do. And like I said, if you use those type of gains to calibrate your data, you get this sort of thing that is called foreground leakage, where now your foregrounds are strictly slightly unsmooth, and so they're pushed into that window, which we call the EOR window. So your foregrounds now get slightly pushed into higher delays than they are supposed to be. And
it's the white lines, it's not the white
line. No, the that's the horizon limit line. So this is
the white ones,
that's RFI. and then these, yeah, that's the horizon. So all your foreground emission is supposed to be within this line, but some of it passes. And this is particularly troublesome for the lower. So the K modes here corresponds to baselines. So they're particularly troublesome for the lower, smaller baselines where they're much more sensitive to diffuse emission. So you get a lot of foreground leakage, but that's where your most sensitivity is as well. So that you pretty much have to deal with this sort of problem. Okay. And so one way of doing this is to use closure phases. So closure phases, in a way, avoid the need for calibration to some extent. So what you do is you form a visibility product. Okay. So you multiply three visibilities. And what happens if you do that is that all your antenna gains factor out. Okay. So these are the various phases from the visibility spectra of the three baselines. And if you add them together, you get the closure spectra or quantity that is just true of the sky signal, independent of these antenna gains. Okay. And so that's one motivation behind using the closure spectra. Okay. And this is just another way to show this, that if you have uncalibrated visibility phase and calibrated visibility phase, the closure spectra of them is still the same. So you don't need to calibrate whatsoever. Yes. No, the antenna gains, they don't need to be the same. They can be different. They can be spectrally unsmooth. We don't mind. But if you use the closure phase, multiply those three products, all the they cancel out. Okay. And so what you get is this neat quantity, okay, that you know allows you to probe the sky as it is without needing to calibrate. So this is just showing with actual data now that you know uncalibrated and calibrated visibilities produce the same visibility spectra. This is all great again. Okay, so great again because somewhat we don't need to calibrate. Okay, and just like the visibility spectra, the closure phase of foregrounds also turns out to be smooth compared to the closure phase of the EOR signal. And so you can also form this neat separation between foregrounds and the EOR, but now you don't have to calibrate. However, we go back to our friend, which is the primary beam. So these are the closure spectra for all the same type of triads. So we call them redundant triads. Basically, they're the same triads. They're supposed to be measuring the same sort of mode of the sky. But what happens is that there's a bit of a variation in the closure spectra between them. So the red is just the median of these. And then all the different colors are showing the closure spectra from the same type of triad. So there's a little bit of deviation between them. And this deviation, again, is unsmooth. Where does this come from? Well, we think part of it comes from the primary beam. And this was the essence of my work. So what we did is we studied this sort of field where you have the galactic foreground, galactic plane in sort of the horizon. It's still there, but it's you know not fully under the horizon. I think the center was somewhere around here. So we studied this sort of setup. We knew that there may be conditions that could be observed in this scenario. And what we found is, well, without any mutual coupling, if your primary beams are nice and everything works out nicely, your power spectrum is pretty much smooth. Okay. However, as soon as you include mutual coupling, you do get now those variations. But this does not completely explain those variations, but to some extent it does, because with mutual coupling, you get variation in the closure spectrum. And if you go to the power spectrum, okay, now because of the side lobe structure of mutual coupling beams, you have also foreground emission going to higher delay. So you got more emission on higher K-modes or higher Fourier modes as a result of using mutual couplings beams. So this was part of my master's project, which carried on to my PhD project, and managed to summarize the result in that sort of paper. Okay. Then we went back. We were like, okay, there are a few couple of problems I'll not discuss now. I don't think I'll have the time to discuss with the closure spectra. But in essence, the closure spectra really doesn't map to a three-dimensional power spectrum, though. So there's a little bit of a thing going on there. So we went back to the visibility-based power spectrum, because that maps into real quantities that you can actually use. So in this project, we basically looked at how does the incompleteness of a sky model affect calibration, and how we can then use what we call fringe rate filters. I'll discuss this later on in the slide to help improve the calibration process, because we know if, to some extent all your models are incomplete, but now if you couple them with unsmooth instrumental response, these create calibration errors. Okay, so we simulated two types of foregrounds. We have gleam sources, those are your compact sources, and then we had diffuse emission. Okay, that's our standard emission. So what we did in this study, we deliberately excluded the diffuse emission in the calibration process. So our sky model was missing the diffuse emission part. Okay, so we wanted to see to what extent does this actually occur. And typical calibration pipelines actually exclude us a good portion of the diffuse emission when we calibrate with Terra. And so let me just quickly discuss what a fringe rate filter. So it turns out with tracking arrays, okay, with non-tracking arrays, that is, if you take the visibility spectra, so if you take the visibility and Fourier transform along the time axis, you get something that we call the fringe rate, okay? And so that's what we mean by fringe rate. But although this is just a simple Fourier transform, it actually maps to real space, because what you get for non-tracking array is that different parts of the sky map to different fringe rates. And so what you can do is, with this fringe rate sort of analysis, you can separate the sky out. And so you see here at the South Pole, okay, this is for, it also depends on the where the declination of your array is. This is just particularly for Hera, but you can see that it lies at zero fringe rate. And then as you go to the equator, then the increase in fringe rate. So that's the motivation here, that you can separate the sky out, okay, by using this sort of technique. And so what we did is we explored two types of fringe rate filters. One, which we call the notch filter, basically filtering everything that's centered around zero fringe rates. And as I mentioned, everything centered around fringe rate is on the South Pole. And if you look at Hera, everything that's on the South Pole is more or less on the side lobes of the beam, always, most of the time. But there are a few other details that I'm leaving out here, but that's the basic essence, that everything on the side pole is more or less on the side lobe. So if you can filter that emission out, then that should sort of improve your calibration. Another one is you can always keep everything that's in the main lobe of the beam and then suppress everything that's outside the main lobe of the beam. And so you get a nice sort of signal to work with that's not spectrally unsmooth at all. And so this is what we did. And so this is, again, showing you the essence in visibility space. So this is the true data, which had foreground and compact sources, the filtered one, and then you have only the gleam sources. So you see that after filtering, you get a better match of the gleam. So you pretty much filtered most of the diffuse emission component out. And so now your raw data and your sky model closely match to each other. And what you get is, I'll skip through this, I'll discuss this later on, is that the gains that you now get once you've done the filtering improve quite significantly, because without doing any filtering, these are the type of gains that you get. If you do some sort of filtering, it also smoothens out your gains a little bit. So you get more robust gains that you can then use for calibration. What we're trying to really do is to suppress this sort of structure. That's what we're trying to suppress. We need to suppress that to get better gains. And we've done that through the use of these fringe rate filters. Okay. And just again, showing you that wedge plot. So this is the case that you would get for perfect calibration, where nothing is wrong with your processing, your sky model is complete. But as soon as it's incomplete, then you get a lot of leakage, okay, at the baselines, again, that are smaller. But you need to preserve those baselines because they are the most sensitive ones. But you get a lot of foreground leakage if you don't do this sort of filtering. But as soon as you do the filtering, it suppresses that emission by a lot. And so that's what we did. And this is, again, just showing the one-dimensional thing. And this was also published nicely. And you can read more about. There are quite a few things that I've left out due to time constraints. But this is the current work that I'm working on. We're also trying to use this is the very same technique now, but not to just target incomplete sky modeling, but to also target the effects of mutual coupling and see if we can improve that. These are like preliminary results that we found. So there is some sort of suppression here. You can see the gains that you get as a result of mutual coupling are spectral and smooth that we expected. But as soon as we do some sort of filtering, there is some improvement. There's drastic improvement as soon as we employ the notch filter. Typically, when we thought about this, we thought that, well, the main lobe filter should perform really great, but turns out it's not that great. There's quite a big discussion on this, but I'll leave it there for now. But, you know, with this sort of thing, we can also improve the calibration of error data. And in summary, I'll leave you with my conclusions there. So the power spectrum limits, so far noise limited. Okay, not all the antennas are up and ready yet. So pretty much noise limit. But eventually, when we reach the sensitivity, systematic effects are going to be, you know, the thing that we need to now look into. And that's the work that I'm doing as well. And the use of closure phases, yes, does improve calibration, but it's also affected by mutual coupling. And fields, I think this we already know that fields with extended foreground emission should be rather avoided. So we always try to do calibration on fields where they are typically only compact sources. So we try to avoid diffuse emission. And currently, like I said, I'm working on using fringe rate filters to mitigate the impact of mutual coupling. Okay, I think that's it. Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks very much. Do we have any questions about remote and open your speaker? Because someone's asking something you want to hear us. For myself, I've got a serious question and I've got a flicker something.
Okay.
We can draw here for a second.
let's hear a serious question.
Yeah, the serious, so your last couple of slides got me to thinking. Of course, so essentially filtering, you are suppressing sources from outside the main lobe from the calibration problem.
Yeah.
So why don't we do this with new guys? Why should we not?
Yeah. Meerkat is a tracking array, right?
Yeah.
So it's not gonna work nicely because as soon as you start tracking, all your emissions goes to zero fringe rates.
Yeah, so the fringe rate is too low also.
Yeah, so you need something that's tracking to order to peel out them, it separates out the emission nicely. So it needs to be a tracking array.
Is it really the tracking that makes a difference? So the fact that it's a large field of view, so the...
Yeah, also the large field of view, but the tracking is the most...
certain things far off the store ahead of it?
I haven't figured. There was a comment by the reviewer on one of these papers, like, could this be applied to other interferometer areas? And we were like, at the time when we saw it, we couldn't, because the technique has been only developed for tracking arrays. In other words, where you're always pointing at zenith and nowhere else. And so you just sky drift. So the assumption built, we don't know how the equation
how much transform. How much of the field of view do you
use? Field of view for her is about 10 degrees. Well, not 10, yeah, 10 degrees half width at maximum height, something. That's the primary beam field of view. It's about 10 degrees. And then, again, her is designed to look at a much larger space for sensitivity purposes. I don't know why it would be useful for... I can say it, but yeah, I also thought about it, but there's the tracking, but also there's the large field of view. And also, do you have troubles with sidewalls in Meerkat?
Yeah.
Like prominent, we have real sidewall problems.
not prominent, of course, but if you have something bright showing up on the sidewalls, sometimes you end up...
Oh, yes.
You need to make larger images, which was involved in the sky model. And,
yes, oh, okay, and okay.
Small subject pointing error if it's on the sidewall.
Oh, yeah.
So it's not a regular case, but it's
something that...
It's a nasty case one. It can be a nasty case one. That's...
Yeah. Now, certainly, that if we could work out the formalism for a tracking array, maybe it could work. Now, I see it. Was it a non-serious one?
The non-serious one, yeah. You mentioned 21 centimeter fast. Do you remember the author is?
No. who's the author of JoJo?
Well, actually, you should, because he said, if I'm not wrong, it's Mario.
Mario, oh! Okay, yeah.
That got me thinking, in 2008 or 2009, we had the very first 3GC workshop. There's been four now. But at the very first one, there was a bet between Mario and another colleague about whether the EOR was going to be detected within 5 years.
Okay.
And I believe Mario bet that it would be detected and lost about Lovisky. So that was 2009. And we were still kind of expecting, you know, Lofar was going to do it. Maybe a semi-serious question, you know, why hasn't it done it yet? Like what group did the dogs not? And the last serious question, what's your estimate? And what kind of bottle are you in?
The current limitation is you just need a lot of antennas and infrastructure. I think the Michelin Wild Interferometer in Australia might be a good bet. Other papers have been saying that as well, that they could even image. So now we're doing power spectrum measurement, but the Michelin Wide Field Array can actually make an image of a 3D image of the UR period, which is the cleanest that you could ever get. We do power spectrum measurements. So I think perhaps they could make a detection. With Hera, I don't know. Hera was sort of an experiment precursor to the array in Australia. But it could constrain a lot of the models, but could it get to the point where we can have a detection of the Jindwans in the emission line? But I have to be honest or just tell you what I believe? Since I'm working with Hera, I do believe maybe Hera could do it. So in the... it's sort of my honest opinion, because there are quite a few techniques that we're developing now with Hera, and also the signal chain is changing every now and then. People are realizing maybe using crappy feeds anymore is not good anymore. So there's quite a good push, and the integration of the new arrays, and we might get it because the power spectrum limits have been going down year by year.
And because there's new observational complexity.
Yeah, usual new observational.
Those keep dropping.
Yeah.
They have installed.
And you can also combine, because the 21 centimeter signal is isotropic, so you can combine different observations together. So my take on it, Hera might do it, but 10 years from now, we should have it. We should have it.
10 years.
10 years.
Learn the lesson on my years, but.
Okay. Yeah.
Cool.
All right. Thank you.
Any more questions from the room? Any more questions from the remote end?
I think that's a figure behind. But when you had all these arrays, then you had at the quantum the extra ones in this.
You mean?
Yeah.
This one?
Yes. So, we're trying to get to the.
Yeah, yeah. Well, that's what we're trying to get to where. Yeah, different arrays who are doing power spectrum measurements, and all of them are trying to constrain this.
So how long has this been happening? This
10 decades. The first one, when I was writing my thesis, it was 10 years ago, the first power spectrum limit.
Yeah.
I don't remember the, but it's been, this one is the latest. This was 2022.
So how far is it now from
the extra? It's so it also depends on redshift. And you can see the higher the redshift, it's not that great. So it also depends on redshift. But we don't probe this error because this is this is reionization right about here. Mm-hmm. And then there's the cosmic dawn eventually, but eventually. So there are people who probe with high redshifts, but again, there's various redshifts that we can get increasingly sensitive power spectrum measurements.
Yeah.
So there's that play as well. So we might be able to detect the EOR signal, can make some vast conclusion, but there's still going to be the cosmic dawn and all those are high, really high redshifted. So you need a lot of sensitivity for them as well. But there's, so this is, although this is like a power spectrum K, sort of K mode measurement, it depicts different periods of the ER. So the ER is somewhere between 6, it ends at 5, it ends at 6, mostly, yes, ends at 6, because there's an alignment, I mean, alpha constraint around here that constrains the ER signal. I actually don't know where it begins now. No, actually, we don't know where it begins. We know where it ends. We don't know where it begins. And then there's a cosmic dawn and all that. So we might get some constraints for the EOR, but then there are still other epochs that we can still probe. Maybe in the 10 years. That's what I'm talking about. That's the EOR. To be specific, the EOR is the one that I'm specifically talking about, not the...
But they have to take... I mean, you mean like for the... Because what... Is the difference between
what
this
thing gives us versus what edges? So the edges measure the global sort of absorption profile so my guess, I don't know exactly because I don't work with the EOR simulations at all, but I do get the sense that with the power spectrum constraints, there are quite a more parameters that you can constrain with EOR. Because we're not just to try and understand the period, but also the type of galaxies that are forming. So there are certain quantities that are constrained to the power spectrum as opposed to. Yeah, it's the overall global scene. Yeah, variations. Yeah. And then you get different modes as well from this.
You know, it might be cool to recast explores. If you plotted year versus distance,
yes. Okay. Oh yeah, yeah, yes, and then show. All right, I'll figure out it. So sky model incompleteness basically says that when you're doing your calibration, it's always to some extent incomplete, your sky model that you put in to calibrate. So it never matches really your raw data. And as a result of that mismatch, you get calibration errors because you don't model that part of the sky. Yeah.
Oh, and also I wanted to ask you, how did you eventually relate like the closure spectrum to that power spectrum?
Yeah, that's a big talk. It's one of the catches about closure phases is that we can't really relate it to the actual power spectrum, because this one maps to like a 3D more physical model, but the closure spectra doesn't map to anything. So as of yet, they're just treated as independent measurements. One thing that we're trying to do though is to run an UR model through the power spectrum and sort of make some conclusions about it. But it's difficult.
Model.
Yeah,
it's
yeah.
Problem again.
Yeah. So it's a sort of that. But with this one, it's nice because it has physical units that you can. All right. Okay.
Cool. Well, neatly brings us to the end of the hour. Thanks very much for the interview again.
Thank you.
Sounds a really interesting talk, Charles. Thank you.
Thank you. Hello.